Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I want to welcome you to Claremont School of Theology and to a very, very exciting special event that is part of our celebration of the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. And I'm really excited that you're here today to be able to share in this way of being able to realize a little more deeply how music played a key role in the Reformation. And so we're very fortunate today to be able to take a little bit of time to begin with to learn more about what Luther did in terms of the Deutsche Messe, and to be able to understand a little bit more deeper what this prompted in terms of the Reformation. And so I want to, first off, just share a little quote real quick. Luther once said, "I have no use for cranks who despise music, because it is a gift from God. Music drives away the devil and makes people joyful. Next to theology, I give music the highest place and the greatest honor." So, again, I'm Tom Johnson. I'm the director of the Lutheran Center here at Claremont School of Theology. And again, we're very thankful that you're here. And I want to now introduce Belva Brown-Jordan, who is our associate dean. And on behalf of our president, great greetings to all of you at Claremont School of Theology.
It is my honor to stand here on behalf of President Jeffrey Kwan, who could not be with us this afternoon, but who's asked me to welcome you and bring you greetings on his behalf. We are honored that this is the space in which this lecture and this service will take place as we remember 500 years of the Reformation. This is a place that is ecumenical in spirit. You may know that we are grounded in, affiliated with the United Methodist tradition, and we engage in interreligious studies, and we have ecumenism as part of who we are. I'm ordained with the Christian Church Disciples of Christ and serve in this place as the Associate Dean. And connected with our Disciple Seminary Foundation across the street. So it is my honor to be here with you. It is my honor that you all have chosen this place for this remembrance and recognition. Welcome.
I want to introduce also, before we begin our service, Bishop Andy Taylor back here from our Pacifica Synod. And he's going to be helping us. Also, Reverend James Pike is going to be doing there. He's right here. He's going to be leading our service. So great to have you here with us as well. And now I want to introduce the person who's really the backbone, who's really the one that we're here to hear, as well as to be able to learn from you and share in the celebration. Adan Fernandez, I want to say almost doctor, is, as you probably know, doing this as a part of his doctoral presentation. And he has served for many years at Good Shepherd Lutheran Church here in Claremont. Many of you know him through that. And just recently he has taken a new position at Holy Name Catholic Church.
Holy Family.
Holy Family Catholic Church. And so we wish him the best, although we're going to miss you. But I want to turn it over to Adan. He's going to give a little lecture beforehand, and then around 3 we will be having our service together. So, Adan, please take it.
So, thank Dr. Johnson for introducing me. He said, almost doctor. Dr. Shrimple's looking at me, he's shaking his head. So, hi everyone, my name is Adan Fernandez. I'm a doctoral student in sacred music at the University of Southern California, where I study organ, musicology, choral music, and sacred music. And my advisors are Dr. Nick Shrimple and Dr. Tram Sparks, along with Dr. Matt Thomas as my organ instructor. Dr. Nick Strickle's right here in the back, so you hands in the way. Maya, would you stand up? He's the distinguished fellow. Thank you. My teachers, my instructors, for my educational strides that I've made over the last year or two, or this is my third year, so last 3 years. And thank you, Dr. Tom Johnson, Director of Center of Lutheran Studies here at the Claremont School of Theology, for collaborating with me on this lecture so to present something wonderful for the 500th commemoration of the Reformation. So, I'm a huge proponent of sacred music, not only for its beauty and message, but for its function. Function gives everything a purpose and therefore validates its existence in varying degrees of importance. Music has been highly discussed and debated for thousands of years, from Augustine to Plato to Boethius, yet we're still discovering new ways that the frequency of sound lingers in people's brains to signify words, ideas, and expressions. It is no wonder then why we flock to those whose music speaks to us, consciously or subconsciously. Luther knew this well and would subsequently create a service that would extrapolate on the multifacets of music. But before I do, we should talk about what it is the Reformation did. I know you've heard a lot about it, but you're going to hear a little bit about more, because you can't understand music of the Reformation outside of the context of what it was really, what really trying to do at the point. There were many ways to understand music of the Reformation. We can understand it in performance practice, historical, biographical, and so on. However, I'm here to talk to you about its function in the Reformation, and in the spread of Lutheran orthodoxy, and how the Deutsche Messe provided a platform for both polemic and catechetical song, ultimately contributing to the German identity and unification against a distant rule by the Pope in Rome. But before that, we have to understand a bit of the medieval world. So in the 15th century, an expert linguist named Lorenzo Valla discovered that a document that had been long recognized to give power to the Pope over worldly affairs was indeed a forgery. This was a document that was supposedly written by Constantine, saying that rulers of the world were there to, they were subject to the Pope. And it wasn't until the 15th century that Valla discredited that and found it was a forgery. So this document, this is just one thing that was starting to lead into doubt into the magisterium's authority and the Pope's rule. So, in 1309, the papacy moved from Rome to the city of Avignon. The papacy believed that they were moving to keep an eye on the politics of France and England. France in this day and age was extremely powerful, so it became suspect that there was a corroboration between the papacy and France. We're kind of going through that today, right? Despite this, the question of whether or not the Pope was the spiritual head was never really doubted. What did come into doubt was his own spirituality. In 1378, the papacy moved back to Rome. But by this time, it led to, as most of us are aware, to the papal schism, where not one, not two, but three popes were selected. One from Rome, one from Pisa, and then one from Avignon. This became a problem, especially for kings and rulers, since there was confusion with who it was that they should consult for pardons or edicts, or who to be accountable to at all. Now, none of this directly contributes to the Reformation, but it does set up the context for anti-clericalism throughout the 15th century. So some of these corruptions that were going on, by the time that Luther comes onto the scene, he was just one of many who had found fault with the church. It is also important to note at this point that corruption was not universal in the church. England, for example, did not experience many or any of the same corruptions as any other nations. First of the corruptions was something called simony. Simony, or its buying of positions of power. This practice was decried by the church, but many noble families took advantage of buying positions of power, two or even three at a time. This resulted in something called pluralism, so you're taking multiple positions. But when you're taking multiple positions, it's hard to be present at it at all. So that contributed to the third corruption, absenteeism. And so what do you do when you're missing from your position? Well, you hire people out. And so they used to get substitutes for them for whenever they were absent. So those, So these practices were common in the Netherlands, in France, and for our purposes in Germany. Luther's breakthrough, a little bit about him. He went through a lot of stress, as we all kind of know. He sums up a mix of stress, sadness, anger, frustration, and other similar emotions into a German word, Anfechtung. This term is best left untranslated, to be honest, but it has to do with facing trials in one's life, kind of like testing. This comes as a result of the grace-based system of the latter Middle Ages, in which Luther finds himself doing penance in order to be saved. Just as troubling also is the problem of something of the will. In the Catholic medieval system, my Catholic friends out there already know about this history. Penance begins actually with conviction. If the sinner didn't hold any compunction or guilt from the sin, nothing they confessed to the priest really held any ground, really. Luther never really felt that he had the compunction, and therefore he lamented that he had never really done anything efficacious to commune with God. This wasn't just a problem with Luther, though. Many had the same struggles with their conviction of sin. This became such a widespread problem that there was a slogan to actually address this. The Latin goes, "Facere quod in se est," which means to do that which is within you. And in today's lingo, that would translate to just do the best you can. That's really what it just means. And that's kind of like putting off Luther into what he was doing. So he was saying, well, I don't feel like I'm convicted of my sin. And the priest would say, well, just do what you can. Like, that's really what it was. Today we will learn Well, Luther found this troubling and would have a marathon of sessions of confession with his Zen mentor, Johann von Staupitz. One session, as Luther mentioned, lasted 6 hours. Imagine 6 hours you're lecturing of all the sins you do. That's not enough. No, but that's... and then Luther reads Romans 1:17. Now, it's not like it's not like he read Romans 1:16 and then skipped to 18 and then he just never saw that. That's not what happened. He just kept on reading it and you know, you have that kind of tower moment where he goes, aha, you know. It's been more of a process, but that reading that is where everything really changes. So the verse reads, for those of you not familiar with it, "For in the gospel the righteousness of God is revealed, the righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteousness will live by faith." And this is really the foundation of the Reformation. It is purely doctrinal from the beginning, but its message rested in the context of a general distrust in the magisterium. The Deutsche Messe and its music must be understood in this context. If its civic contribution as polemic song, catechism, cantor factum, which is just same music, new words, and not to mention its medieval roots. All right, so Luther's upbringing. We're familiar with his education, for the most part, but he has a very musical education. One of the things I love about Luther is this connection to both folk song and chant, because I kind of grew up similarly. I listened to punk rock growing up, and I also played classical piano. Luther's talents brought him to Eisenach at 14, where he supported himself as a singer. These singers were known as Corrente boys, but it was a common thing for boys to sing door-to-door for money in Eisenach. So Luther would go door-to-door and would sing throughout the year in order to make a living as a kid at 14. He learned to sing Hymnodic songs and polyphonic motets from a priest named Johannes Brahms. He loved music. Keep in mind that at this time, he is learning a method of composition known as Stile Antiguo or Prima Practica. This is about the early 16th century, so he's learning the strict way of writing music. So it's a Prima Practica. Now that'll change when we get to Monteverdi in 1600, when he develops a second practice of music. But Luther kind of foreshadows this when in the Deutsche Messe, which I'll talk about in a minute. On the other side of the coin, Luther also learns folk songs, known as Volkslieder, while at the University of Erfurt. He became a proficient lutist, and would later sing songs around the table with his family. So, philosophy of music. Music is always debated in its application and understanding in both academia and temporal application, its worldly application. Is it functional? Is it purely conjecture? These kinds of questions have provoked some awesome answers from philosophers over the last 2,000 years. Boethius and Augustine taught us about musica universalis, or universal music, or the music of the universe, and musica instrumentalis, or instrumental music. Music that is hypothetical and philosophical, and music that is practical and useful in daily living. In the age of humanism, scholars were referring to the ancient Greek texts for a wider, encompassing approach to music. Now, Luther wasn't completely a humanist, but he did reject the method of scholasticism for its narrow approach of study. This is important in understanding Luther's approach to music in what would become his Deutsche Messe. So the German Mass, or the Deutsche Messe I've been referring to, comes at a time when the liturgy of the Catholic Church was primarily in Latin, with the exception of the Greek Kyrie. It was not common for laity to have Bibles, and most people couldn't read. German laity were at the whim of the church and their interpretations of scripture. So the vernacular seemed like a natural solution. Now, it is important to note that the Catholic Church should not be seen as some antagonist in the history of the Reformation, as corruption was localized and exceptions were made in the 10th century for vernacular Bibles in the case of the Moravians. So we actually have vernacular scripture as early as the 10th century. But it was an exception. Germany, however, was well established in Catholicism by Luther's time. It would come as suspect or outright subversive to even consider having a vernacular mass outside the traditional Catholic Latin. Luther translated the Latin mass into the language of the people. Now, remember that Luther had already translated the New Testament in 1522, and the German mass is first heard in 1526. In the Advent season of 1525 is when actually he wrote it, but anyway, the Deutsche Messe comes at the heels of his translation, really, of the New Testament. The main difference, however, is how Luther repurposed the German Mass from the Latin Mass. The Catholic Mass had something called the canon, which is typically understood as the Eucharistic prayer after the offertory. The language of the Roman canon, according to Luther, signified a sacrifice, or a sacrifice on behalf of the laity, which was, according to his doctrine of justification, unnecessary since Christ had already done the work. The Roman canon, or Eucharistic prayer, had sections that read, I wrote down the whole Latin, but I'll just read down the translation. Through him we ask you to accept and bless these gifts we offer you in sacrifice. Another section of the canon reads, remember all of us gathered here before you. You know how firmly we believe in you and dedicate ourselves to you. We offer you this sacrifice of praise for ourselves and those who are dear to us. We offer you this, we pray to you, our living and true God, for our well-being and redemption. So there's somewhat language in that. Therefore, the language of the sacrifice in the Roman canon was detestable to Luther. In Luther's An Order of Mass and Communion for the Church in Wittenberg, he writes, quote, let us therefore repudiate everything that smacks of sacrifice, together with an entire canon, and retain only that which is pure and holy, and so order our Mass. And when I say quote, I mean in German. I mean, that was a translation, so. Therefore, Luther repurposed the Mass so it would become a proclamation of the Gospel as a whole, of the work that Christ had done, and then that we had done nothing to deserve it. We could do nothing to merit his grace. So how does that look musically? Well, Luther was a student of the medieval modes and understood them well. The modes are a complicated system of note sets that have been written about and explored at great length. Luther was a student of the eight modes, like many students of the University of Wittenberg. When a professor there in the early 16th century named Adan von Fulda, for example, was a composer in Duke Frederick the Wise's employment. Now, anyone recognize the name Frederick the Wise? Mm-hmm. No? Mm-hmm. So Frederick the Wise was the Catholic who saved Luther's life by arranging a safe passage to and from the Diet of Worms. Now, he saved Luther's life, a Catholic, and so Luther had an immense influence. But Adam von Fulda, the theorist, as I was just mentioning, he died in Wittenberg in 1505. But before he did, he wrote about the modes. And he wrote that mode 8, and I'll sing them for you. I'll try to sing them for you in a minute. He wrote that tone 8, or it's for our music theorists out there, it's the high-low mixolydian, was the mode of wisdom, and that tone 5 was a mode of joy. The first tone of the Dorian mode is usually associated with a strong and vigorous character in the ancient Greek understanding of ethos in music. So here are the modes. tone 1, serious. Tone 4, as I'll get to, is harmonious or tender. Mode 5, happy. And mode 6, pious or devout, according to the theorists of the of Greek and Boethius and Adam von Fulda. So this is the Dorian mode. Since the Deutsche Messe was originally written during Advent in 1525, it's that period of 4 weeks before Christmas. Luther did not originally have the glory, so there's no glory in the original Deutsche Messe, but that's because during penitential times, such as Advent or Lent, you don't sing the Gloria, and so he rightfully respected that. But when the Gloria was added, Luther designated it to use the fourth mode, or hypofrigian mode, which is the harmonious or tender mode. In liturgy, the Gloria is a response to the Kyrie. The Kyrie, you're pleading for God and His forgiveness, and the Gloria is pretty much saying, "Oh yeah, I am forgiven," and so now it's more harmonious, and you're responding to that prayer you just sang in the Kyrie. So the fourth mode was thought to have a tender feeling, according to theorist Adam von Fulda. And on a side note, it was common to have these character designations to each mode. Like I just mentioned, it goes back to the ancient Greeks, to Guido de Arezzo in the 10th century, to Adam von Fulda in the 16th century, to Juan de Espinosa Medrano in the 17th century. A lot of people have been writing about this, and it's not new. We hear about it in Descartes and the Passions that he wrote, and the Doctrine of Affections in general. For example, theorist Guido de Arezzo felt that the fourth mode, this is the harmonious mode, remember this is the glory, felt that the fourth mode incited harmony, while Espinosa Medrano felt that the fourth mode incited delights. You be the judge. You know, you can really write books about this and be really opinionated about it. Regardless, Luther designated these modes to different readings with these character traits in mind. Throughout the service, so to serve the text, which would, as a result, highlight the gospel. So the readings that you'll hear at the Deutsche Messe will be sung in those tones to the best of my transcription abilities. So they'll be actually sung in the character traits that I've read. The result is actually a symmetry in the service. Theologically speaking, it makes the service of the word in the beginning of the first half of the Mass a reflection of the service of the table in the second half of the Mass. Musically speaking, it also foreshadowed other forms and practices in the 17th century. So this is it, according to Mose, if you can kind of see that. Squinting helps. Later composers would use something called the arch form, The result is like a musical palindrome. Arch form is comparable to when you spell out words like palindromes, like grace cards, the beginning of the verse and the last. Musical arch form is similar in that way, where one section is also the ending section, the second section is always the penultimate section, and the third section is the antepenultimate section. I paid $500 for those words, so. Now, Monteverdi used musical palindromes in his music in the 17th century. It wasn't unheard of. His Vespers of 1610, for example, modeled the arch form in his Magnifica. The Deutsche Messe provided an organic form that the listener could listen to and really align his emotions and intellect through music. This also foreshadows a second practice of Monteverdi in which the music seeks to serve the text. Luther was doing this already when he was talking about the readings, and we designate certain readings of the gospel. So let's move on to some hymns. Well, this is a good quote, at least I can read this. Author Rebecca Odinger writes that Luther's songs in particular gave the neonate Protestant population a sense of themselves as community. Evangelical church songs soon became battle hymns against Catholics, even when an explicit anti-Catholic rhetoric was absent. So, just like today, hymns and songs of the Reformation were used tongue-in-cheek kind of ways. Other times they spoke blatantly against the Pope or the Magisterium. The hymns were either taken from previous Catholic sequences. The Catholic sequences are chants that would come right after the priest, right before the priest's sermon. They would also come from songs that were already commonly known, folk songs, and more hymns would also come from some combination of the two. But an important aspect of the of German hymnody during the 16th century is how it flourished because of the Deutsche Messe. It thrived because it was given a prominent platform, one that everyone could now understand. In fact, the German hymnal gained over 1,000 editions over the course of a century and was meant to be used in church, school, and in the home. The Catholics tried to catch up at the same time after the Council of Trent. But they never quite did it the way the Protestants did in publication. Now remember, at the end of the 15th century, we have the printing press that sped up everything, and the Reformation largely owes its spread to that. But combine that with singing in public squares for people that can't read, and hymnals at home that you can sing songs that have memorable tunes to, and you have the spread of an unstoppable force. In fact, Luther also wrote prefaces to many of the hymnals in which he designated its goal to educating the young generation in Lutheran orthodoxy. The Lutheran church was spreading and the hymn was helping to perpetuate that. So, as an Augustinian monk, Luther sang psalms and was very familiar with the chants of the daily office, which were daily prayer sessions that primarily used the psalms as modes of sung prayer. Luther took some of those chants and altered them. For example, take the Latin sequence, Victime Paschali, Paschali Laudes. Now listen carefully. Victime Paschali Laudes. And I can't see my own word. Da 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 Christiani. And now, there's also a folk song that was based on the same sequence. A song on Easter. You get the joke. And now the one that Luther wrote, Chris Lagin Todes Manden, da 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 da. So those are three separate musical tunes, but each one is kind of taken from the Victime Paschali Laudes of the Catholic Church. The idea was that if you knew the tune by memory or it sounded familiar, the easier it was going to be to sing new text and therefore remember it. This also added another dimension to the Deutsche Messe. You could alternate. The idea of alternation, or alternatim as it was known, was not new by any means, since Catholics had been doing it with choirs, organists, and so on for some time before Luther. However, it was new to alternate languages in service, which could be done with tunes that had two different texts and languages attached to them. During the hymn, for example, the congregation, during the Victim of Pascal Ilagas that I just sang, the congregation would sing the Christlagen Todesbanden by Luther first, and then follow that verse with the Latin chant, Victim of Pascal Ilagas. And then it would continue back and forth, and it would continue that way on and on. This went on as long as nothing from the Catholic hymn had any objectionable items in Luther's eyes, such as extensive devotion to Mary or other items pertaining to purgatory. So Luther would just edit those out. So now, keep in mind also that Luther, what he did with the Deutsche Messe was not a prescription by any means. He did not mean any of these all services to look exactly the same. And that's very different from the Catholic understanding, Catholic literally meaning universal. You can go to any Catholic church in the world and you can still sing Mass of the Angels or the funeral Mass, Sanctus, I forget now. But the chants are the same, and you can really go to any Catholic church and they would have a Liber Musicalis or any Roman Gradualis right there waiting for you. Now, German Lutheranism was very different. Different towns had their own hymnals. Pastors would write their own hymnals, and they would use it to spread news afar. They would use it to spread gospel. They would use it to spread propaganda. Propaganda meaning just to spread ways to get you to be on one side. We'll see if the sound works on the next one. So another example that Luther used as a result of his Catholic upbringing was Cum Heiliger Geist. It was based on Latin sequence Veni Sanctus Spiritus as a text, but as you'll hear, Luther's hymn has the influence of folk song from folk song leaders commonly referred to at the time as Meistersingers in the German regions. Now, we had Meistersingers in Germany, and we also had troubadours and troubères in France. As a lutist, Luther was a proficient musician, but he was also keenly aware of writing memorable tunes so that the congregation could sing the text and remember it well. And again, Luther would alternate the hymns and tunes of both Latin and German. And it's my personal opinion that he probably would have ended with the German, kind of like a last word, so he probably might set it up that way. In the case of the Cum Heiliger Geist, he ends the last verse with, Come Holy Fire, comfort true, grant us the will, your work to do, and in your service to abide. Let trials turn us not aside, Lord, by your power prepare each heart, and to our weakness, strength impart that bravely here. We may contend through life and death to you, our Lord ascend. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So let's hopefully we can listen to at least the Veni Sanctus.
So that's an example of a Roman Catholic.
memory. Athletes are also aware of this as well. Actually, at the beginning, I want to say about 500. This is just something I'm remembering right now, so it's not in my notes. Priests had to be able to memorize the entire Psalter. And it wasn't uncommon for people to memorize the entire Psalter because they had to sing it weekly in the daily office. It's not uncommon for a lot of priests to memorize that at all, just like it's not uncommon for Muslim spiritual leaders to memorize the entire Quran. I met a few just the other day that have the whole thing memorized, and lo and behold, through song. So here's the one by Luther Kom Heiliger Geist, inspired by the same text, but listen for the tune.
As a reminder, was a movement not unsimilar to what we have today,
where the emotional response to Scripture is really what matters, naturally language that induced emotional responses was encouraged and very common, as a line from today's Obone Yesu shows. It's one of the lines in piece reads, "Jesus, the angel supreme ornament, in the ear sweet songs, sweet food in my mouth, my soul always longing for you." So very emotionally evoking words. Other hymns took on catechetical roles as teaching roles. Meaning, these are the holy Ten Commandments. To teach the Ten Commandments, he used another hymn too, named In Gottes Namen fahren wir, or In God's Name We Travel. So basically, he wrote a piece, he wrote words for to teach the Ten Commandments, but he used another tune named In God's Name We Travel. Now, this original tune was originally meant to be sung by German pilgrims. Luther juxtaposed this tune with the Ten Commandments in order to convey a dual meaning. Now, this is not something that I came up with. This is something that is still being debated on. Some people that talk about this are Robin Lieber of Harvard, but it's not, you can't really know and ask Luther, is that what he meant? You know, we can't really know for certain. But it does lend itself to meaning that the commandments were to keep guideposts in life. So the commandments were like a journey into themselves. So just to refrain and repeat that, he wrote words that would teach the Ten Commandments, but he used a tune that was sung by German pilgrims in order to understand the Ten Commandments as some kind of journey throughout life. Does that make sense? Now, I end this presentation, this part of this lecture, with Luther's signature hymn. Now, in your programs, you'll see on the very last page, the very faded part, that is actually Luther's manifest of work. We're not going to sing from there, but hopefully some of us don't have copies of it, so just do the best you can when we get to the singing part. We're going to end by singing. So I'm just a board or a mighty fortress is our God. It is iconic for its way of encompassing the singability from the Meister singer influence and the conjunct or stepwise motion of chant. He combined both worlds from his chant training to his folk song training into his hymn, and we get a mighty fortress from that. What makes this hymn stand out is its awkward rhythm, originally, not the one we have today. It's this awkward rhythm which acts as kind of as a microcosm of the uncertainty of the Reformation and all of its turmoils. We say a commemoration because after Luther nailed his 95 theses, a chain of reactions led to much bloodshed, like the likes of the world had never seen by that point. However, the changes wrought in the Reformation give rise to something an author named Paul Tillich identifies as something called the Protestant principle, which he summarizes as a constantly reforming state of mind. A mighty fortress or ein fester Burg speaks out about the devils among us. People would sing this during the Deutsche Messe, and though they were still singing to God in worship, they also knew that the devils they were singing about were the magisterium or the Pope of the 16th century. It has been sung by Gustavus Adolphus, shown here in the picture. Gustavus Adolphus, during the 30 Years' War in 1631, he sang that hymn as a battle cry going into war. It was sung by, and Dr. Schimmelkirk can correct me if I'm wrong, it was sung by Jews in, I believe, Turesian stuff. Looking for confirmation. Can I consider that the comment as part of my lecture? And they also sang it. It's also very common in Mendelssohn's Reformation Symphony, where it is the tune in the last, I think, the fifth movement. People knew there was a dual meaning. So at this point, if you have a copy of Abiding Fortress, I don't know if I've made enough copies, but if you see someone next to you, please just share with them. And so I'll sing the first verse, and this is going to be done a cappella. I'll sing the first verse. A mighty fortress is our God, a sword and shield victorious. He breaks the cruel oppressor's rod and wins salvation glorious. The old